The atmosphere of the Earth, viewed from space, nothing but a narrow belt of shimmering blue, a protective zone between us and the vast universe. Astronauts tell us about its breathtaking beauty, but they also tell us how fragile and vulnerable the Earth appears in hostile space. If the Earth were the size of an apple, the atmosphere would be just as thick as the apple's skin. Without this tiny, fragile-looking belt, our planet would be too cold to support higher life. Mean temperature on the Earth would be a freezing minus 18 degrees Celsius. But in reality, the Earth is much warmer than that. Why? Because the Earth's atmosphere functions like a greenhouse. It has natural and man-made gases that retain a portion of the sun's energy as heat. That is why we call them greenhouse gases. One of the most important of these is carbon dioxide, CO2. The natural CO2 content in the atmosphere has hardly fluctuated since the last ice age. 10,000 years of human history transpired within a stable climate. During this period, there were never more than 300 particles of CO2 per 1 million other particles in the atmosphere. Or, in scientific terms, the concentration of CO2 in the atmosphere never exceeded 300 parts per million. Really, never more than 300. Never, that is, until roughly 170 years ago, when humans started burning massive quantities of coal, oil, and natural gas. Combustion of fossil fuels produces carbon dioxide. The CO2 content in the atmosphere began to increase with the start of the industrial age. From a geological point of view, it increased at a furious pace. The concentration of CO2 was still at 285 parts per million at around 1850. Then it rose to 340 by 1980 and was already at 419 in 2021. More than half of this tremendous rise occurred over the last 40 years. As humans produced more greenhouse gases, Earth's temperatures also increased. We are heating up our planet. We have begun altering the protective skin around our Earth, triggering changes beyond mankind's historic experience. However, these changes could have been much worse if not for our oceans, forests, wetlands, and soils, which absorb huge quantities of heat and carbon dioxide. They help us, but even their capacities are limited. Any CO2 that oceans and terrestrial ecosystems cannot absorb, roughly 45% of our CO2 emissions end up in the atmosphere. And 20 to 35% remain there for thousands of years. What does this mean for the long term? Quite simple. As long as we humans continue producing excess CO2, this greenhouse gas will continue accumulating. The CO2 concentration in the atmosphere will rise and rise. However, producing a steady excess of CO2 is like throwing stones into an already existing pile of stones. Even if we reduce the amount thrown, such as by throwing fewer or smaller stones, the pile will still keep growing. And as long as more CO2 is released into the atmosphere, the Earth will keep getting hotter. At its core, this is a simple physical relationship. And the more the temperature rises, the more drastic the consequences of climate change will be. If we want to avoid a heat age, we must stop the accumulation of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere completely. We have to reach net zero emissions. In 2015, at the United Nations Climate Conference in Paris, the international community agreed to set a limit on global warming. If possible, global temperatures should remain significantly less than 2 degrees warmer compared to the start of the industrial age. Or even better, reduce the impact of climate change by setting the limit to 1.5 degrees. And where do we stand today? Since the beginning of the industrial age, we've already heated up our planet by roughly 1.1 degrees Celsius. And we do not want to exceed 1.5 or at most 2 degrees Celsius. This leaves us with a narrow range of 0.4 to 0.9 degrees Celsius if we are to comply with the Paris Agreement. With this information, we can use climate models to calculate the maximum quantity of carbon dioxide we can afford to emit while still achieving our climate goals. In scientific terms, this is known as the remaining carbon budget. And how much of the global carbon budget is left? Based on current scientific calculations, we have a 2/3 chance of limiting global warming to 1.5 degrees if we, as humans, emit no more than 400 gigatons of CO2 starting from 2021. At 500 gigatons of CO2, this probability drops to 50%. In other words, if we emit more than 500 gigatons of CO2, there is a 50% probability to fail and not stay within the 1.5 degree limit. These are the recent figures of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, IPCC, published in August 2021 in its current report on the physical science basis of climate change. The corresponding global carbon budget to stay below 2 degrees warming are 1,150 gigatons of CO2 at a probability of 66% and 1,350 gigatons of CO2 at a probability of 50%. Just who are we? We, not just a single person, nor is it only Germany or Europe. It's the remaining carbon budget for the entire global community. And by the way, historically, industrialized countries have used up the largest fraction of the carbon budget. Moreover, CO2 is also joined by other greenhouse gases released into the atmosphere through human activities, like methane, for example. Our remaining carbon budget could increase or decrease by up to 220 gigatons, depending on whether the concentration of these other gases also decreases or increases over the coming years. Perhaps 400, 500, or even 1,150 gigatons sounds like a lot, but it's actually very, very little compared to our present emissions. Currently, humans altogether release approximately 40 gigatons of carbon dioxide in a single year. Of this, roughly 34 gigatons come from fossil fuels and industrial production, and an additional 6 gigatons are from land use, such as agriculture or deforestation. But how much is 40 gigatons of CO2? Well, 40 giga is 4 with 10 zeros. Not very descriptive, is it? So let's use a different approach. How long would a train be if it carried coal equal to 40 gigatons of CO2? 40 gigatons of carbon dioxide. That corresponds to a coal train extending roughly 60 times around the equator, or 3 times from Earth to the Moon and back. Returning to the metaphor of the stone pile, this is the gigantic quantity of stones that we humans are throwing at the Earth's climate system. If we continue at this rate, we are likely to exceed the 2-degree limit by the middle of the century. Many already doubt whether a limit of 1.5 degrees is still realistic at all. But as long as this train continues to run, even with fewer carriages, the CO2 content in the atmosphere will continue to rise, and with it, global temperatures. Currently, we are on a course for a temperature rise of at least 3 degrees by the end of this century. And what exactly does this mean? Quite simple. We have to reach net zero carbon dioxide emissions as quickly as possible. We've already lost valuable time, and the longer we wait, the harder the task will be. This highly simplified animation shows why it's important to take action immediately and not put off this task. This animation makes no attempt to represent all the uncertainties, nor is this necessary to understand our situation. Let's first assume that starting from 2020, we still have a budget of 500 gigatons of CO2 available to meet the 1.5 degree climate target. The global community could still emit a total of 500 gigatons of CO2 before net zero emissions have to be reached. What would the situation have been like in 1990? When the IPCC presented its first report in 1990, the global CO2 emissions were still at roughly 28 gigatons per year. A large portion of our since depleted carbon budget would still have been available. Instead of roughly 500 gigatons, we would still have a reserve of around 1,500 gigatons. If the global community, especially if the industrialized countries, had already taken consistent action at that time, we would have been far better off today. Our route to net zero emissions would have been easier, and we would have had a lot more time to get there. Instead, CO2 emissions have continued to rise. Industrialized countries have not made sufficient reductions, while emerging countries like China and India have caught up to their industrial counterparts. So over these 30 years, we have consumed a large portion of the CO2 budget that was still available in 1990. The result? To reach net zero, we now have to reduce our CO2 emissions faster and with far greater effort in order to maintain a tolerable climate. This is because we are starting at a much higher level and have far less time to stop producing excess CO2. We must change more in less time. Referencing our graph, the route to net zero has become steeper. And the longer we wait and the more CO2 we continue to emit, the steeper, the harder, and the more expensive it will become. The bad news. If we, as a global community, act inadequately, not at all, or only reluctantly to achieve net zero emissions, the resulting climate change will have increasingly catastrophic effects on our lives, affecting us, our children, and future generations. But there's also good news, news that should motivate us. All the steps we set now to protect the climate will pay for themselves, because they will make the route less difficult than the one we would have to take if we were to waste any more years. We can therefore still do a lot in the 2020s to positively affect future climate change. If we, as a global community, take the right course right now and towards net zero emissions. Let us remember, when we look up at the stars, the sky seems infinite. But when we look down from the stars to the earth, we see that the protective skin between us and the vastness of space is just a narrow belt of shimmering blue. Only an intact atmosphere makes the Earth a planet to live on for humans and for life as we know it. And among all the stars, the Earth remains our only home.